Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. The official geological history of the planet Mars is a confused and murky tale filled with contradictions and shifting narratives. Astonishing scientific data obtained in the last decade has only deepened the storyteller's confusion. At the recent 8th International Conference on Mars, leading scientists from around the world discussed the possible solutions to the Martian puzzles. The July 24th edition of the journal Nature outlined some of the problems facing Mars investigators. Mars researchers have found it increasingly hard to explain how the planet might have stayed warm and wet in its early history, if billions of years ago the Martian atmosphere had consisted mostly of carbon dioxide, as scientists suspect. It would not have kept the planet warm enough for liquid water to exist for long periods of time. The scientists are now speculating that Mars may have once been similar to Antarctica today. But as planetary geologist James Head summarizes, this is completely different than what we thought about before. Mars geologist Phil Christensen also confesses, "There's a lot of knowledge and not so much understanding." We asked Thunderbolt's Picture of the Day managing editor Stephen Smith for an overview of the Mars geological mysteries, beginning with the question, why do planetary scientists' theories about Mars continue to change so dramatically?
The simple answer is that there are more instruments orbiting Mars as well as more landers on the surface. Orbital cameras show them a planet with structures that look like those found on Earth. They use theories that were developed to explain what's found here, and then they transfer those theories into other environments. The Phoenix mission, for instance, was sent to Mars in 2007 and landed in the Martian northern latitudes. One of the experiments it performed was to dig several trenches in the regolith to see what could be discovered a few inches beneath the surface. The trenches showed them white chunks of something that NASA immediately stated was frozen water ice. And after several hours, the white chunks disappeared, which the mission team announced was because atmospheric pressure is so low on Mars that the ice sublimed directly into vapor without leaving any liquid traces. And that could be what happened. One problem with the explanation is that when Phoenix landed on Mars, it had an electronic probe that was used to penetrate the sandy soil. If water was located close to the surface, so that the trenches could dig up ice, the probe should have detected an electric current because the water beneath the surface would have conducted electricity. Since the probe didn't detect an electric current, it actually returned a completely null reading. It suggests to me that the ice was actually frozen carbon dioxide. And indeed, Phoenix expired when it was buried in almost 9 meters of dry ice, which is frozen carbon dioxide, during the Martian winter. Also, they detect what they think is water vapor outgassing from different regions on Mars. And personally, what I think they're seeing is the same thing that they think they're seeing on comets. Many of my Picture of the Day articles expand on what Wal Thornhill has explained about water supposedly detected around comets. What happens is that the solar wind, mostly hydrogen nuclei, combines with ionized oxygen from a comet, and that creates hydroxyl molecules. So the same thing happens with Mars. Since Mars has no magnetic field, it has virtually no resistance to the solar wind impinging directly on its surface. And since there's abundant carbon dioxide on Mars, that's what comprises most of its atmosphere, the same thing occurs there as on comets. The solar wind ions combined with ionized oxygen atoms create hydroxyl compounds. The energy for that chemistry is provided by the electrified environment that exists on Mars. And listeners should familiarize themselves with Wall's holoscience.com article called First Evidence of Comet Ice, What Does It Mean? For more information.
On the Martian surface, NASA sees river channels and other features that flowing water supposedly created. However, As explained in the documentary film, The Lightning-Scarred Planet Mars, countless of these features defy such reasoning under close inspection.
The gigantic canyons on Mars, such as Valles Marineris and Tractis Catena, exhibit characteristics that preclude water. There aren't any deltas, the bottoms of the canyons are flat, and there's no evidence that water cut them. Also, the canyons and trenches have steep cliffs rising vertically from the bottoms, with evidence that fulgurites, or formations created by lightning, are embedded in the canyon walls. In these two cases, though, the lightning must have been thousands of times more powerful than anything on Earth or anything seen on Mars. Another thing to consider is the so-called water flows seen on the edges of gullies as well as the walls of some craters. And according to Alan Triman in the Journal of Geophysical Research, about as mainstream a scientific journal as you can get, he said, "The morphology and distribution of gullies on Martian slopes have been attributed to the action of liquid water at the surface and in the near subsurface. However, evidence for involvement of water was circumstantial and by analogy with earthly landforms that are mediated by liquid water. Here it is shown that dry flows of aeolian dust or silt can have all the geological features observed in the gullies, and that their spatial distribution on Mars is consistent with atmosphere circulation models. Many details of this hypothesis remain to be investigated, but it is wholly consistent with earlier inferences and interpretations of the present-day Martian environment. No liquid water and dominated by aeolian processes." In other words, what Alan Triman is saying is that dry avalanches of dust as well as wind action are responsible for features that are constantly highlighted in various publications as water-based.
Mars displays a massive hemispheric dichotomy, with the southern hemisphere saturated with craters and the northern hemisphere excavated up to 6 miles deep with remarkably few craters.
With meteor bombardment, one would expect that craters would be randomly distributed on the surface. After all, why would meteors preferentially strike one face of a planet or a moon over another? The northern hemisphere of Mars, with its central uplift region, could be considered the largest crater in the solar system. Since electricity tends to follow spatial transmission lines called Birkeland currents that are wrapped in electromagnetic fields, if the discharge at the North Pole of Mars was the result of an external electric field or fields, and the electrified object or plasma phenomenon was aligned with the pole, then that's where the arc would make contact. And since it would have enveloped the planet as material was excavated from the north and ionized, it would follow the field around to the South Pole and deposit material there. And that indeed is what is seen on Mars.
Known processes in electrical engineering and plasma science could account for much of the baffling Martian geology. What are some of the best clues that electrical laboratory experiments might provide for planetary scientists in the future?
Supposing that exogeologists conduct these experiments, which in my mind is doubtful, I suggest that they use high-energy electric discharges in various configurations on a variety of materials. Some experimenters have already done research using relatively low power because of the many dangers from high-frequency, high-amperage electrical devices. Powerful arcs can generate extreme ultraviolet light or even X-rays that are deleterious if seen without shielding or welder's goggles at the very least. Goggles are no good against X-rays, though. Only lead shielding is sufficient. University labs are about the only places where such energetic experiments might be conducted safely. I would also just suggest that ferrohydrodynamics be considered as part of their repertoire. Some hobbyists and scientists are using ferrofluids to explore the activity of electromagnetic fields on magnetically sensitive materials, like nanoparticles of iron suspended in viscous fluids. Also, how magnetic fields interact with finely divided iron oxide dust should be explored. Since the surface of Mars is covered with iron oxides in the form of hematite and magnetite, if electrical events on Mars are ever considered to have taken place in the recent past, many problems and difficult explanations might be resolved.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.